Hachette Audio presents Don't Be a Victim, Fighting Back Against America's Crime Wave. Written by Nancy Grace with John Hassan. Read by Nancy Grace. Dedicated to David. You changed my life. Introduction. Now, it seems like another world, a world where I set out to follow my dream of teaching Shakespearean literature. When I studied all of his works in the silence of a library, everything else seemed to disappear. I couldn't think of anything I'd rather do, and I planned a lifetime of doing just that. But that all changed. I remember pushing through the heavy doors of Mercer University's math building. I had just finished a statistics exam, and after a few more classes, I was heading for a graduate program in Shakespearean studies. It was all right there within my reach. And I distinctly remember thinking, as I stepped out of the darkened halls, how the world looked so bright and shiny and new outside. I headed across campus to my job in the library, stopping to use a payphone and let the librarians know I was en route. They gave me the message to call my fiancé's sister, Judy. Right then, I knew. I kept trying to dial the numbers, but my hand wouldn't cooperate. It was like a moth batting around an outdoor porch light, back and forth in erratic, darting movements. I couldn't quite get the numbers straight, but then I did. I don't know how I knew, but I knew. I asked her one question. Is Keith gone? She said, yes. I hung up the phone, and that was the beginning of a dark, hazy blur, a blur that ended up lasting for years. Everything was fine. Everything was perfect. And then, in a flash, it all changed. Just before our wedding, Keith's world ended. My world exploded. I grew up in a world where there was nothing but tall pine trees and soybean fields as far as the eye could see, where violence was something unknown and very, very far away. We could ride our bikes anywhere we wanted after school. We could build forts between pine trees and only come home when we'd hear chimes in the church steeple telling us it was 6 o'clock and time for supper. I could explore rushing streams and pastures full of cows munching grass and edged with trees. I could swing from a long rope out in a circle over a deep gully full of water, crash running once I hit the soil when the circle ended. Keith's murder changed all that. I found out about an alternate universe, a world of violence and unnamed hate. I couldn't eat, couldn't sleep. I couldn't stand to hear music or the TV. My mom had to stop the clocks because I couldn't bear the tick, tick, ticking. I dropped out of school. Weeks, then months passed. I would sit for days on our front porch in the hot sun. I was fading away, mentally and physically. Nothing mattered. In a last-ditch effort, my parents sent me to visit my sister, who had made it to the Wharton School in Philadelphia. I remember sitting on a bench watching students pouring in and out of the bookstore. They were getting books and supplies to go back to school for fall semester. Back to school. I knew I could never be happy in a classroom, not anymore. I had to do something. But what? Sitting on that bench outdoors in the late afternoon, I had an inkling of an idea, an inkling that turned into a life's devotion. Heaven threw me a rope, and even though I didn't realize it at the time, I grabbed it. Yes, I went back to school, but teaching literature was no longer an option for me. My one burning goal was to somehow get into law school and then fight crime with all my might. I had only one reference to present to the law school admissions department from my Sunday school teacher. I remember riding by the law school and seeing the lights burning in the library into the night and wondering if I could possibly get in. Wondering if good grades and a letter from a Sunday school teacher could possibly be enough. And then I got a letter. It was sitting in our black metal mailbox at the end of our driveway near the road, which had finally been paved over just a few years before. The pavement is important because when I opened the letter and read it, I remember the hard asphalt when I went down on my knees and thanked God I got in. Before my first day of law school, I actually had to look up the definitions of plaintiff and defendant. It took me 7 years before I struck my first jury and tried my first jury trial in inner city Atlanta, which was at the time one of the murder capitals of the country. For the next 10 years, I had a life very different from the way it was before or after. For 10 years, an ordinary person like me had an extraordinary opportunity to speak for those who could not speak for themselves and be their voice in courts of law. Fighting crime is nothing like what you see on TV and in movies. Being on a real murder scene is something I wish on no one. The sight, the smell, the malice hanging in the air is something I never forget. It sticks with you. Other cases stuck in my heart. I remember a little girl with 100 pigtails on her head, just 3 feet tall. She was the victim of repeated rapes by mommy's boyfriend. Turned out he had been molesting young girls for 30 years. I found 7 of them and brought similar transactions before the jury when the little girls were too afraid to testify. But they did. I remember Miss Leola, the mom of a teen boy gunned down in cold blood over $10, knitting during the trial when testimony was too raw or crime scene photos and bloody clothes were too unsettling for her to look up. But Miss Leola wouldn't leave, not during witnesses, not during arguments, not during jury selection, not during graphic photos of her son on the autopsy table, as the medical examiner testified to mortal wounds. Standing at the jury rail, I looked over at her sitting in the very first row behind me. Miss Leola would look right back at me, smile, and continue knitting, urging me on. She gave me strength, and even the recollection of her renews me. I remember so many families of murder victims lining up to come into the courtroom and sitting on the hard wooden pews, numb. Standing before many a jury to deliver final closing arguments, I argued this. There are people in our society who are too weak, too poor, too afraid, or too intimidated to speak for themselves and be heard. It is our duty to speak for them and fight injustice in every way we can, in every place we can, whenever we can, as hard as we can, for as long as we can. After well over 20 years, I still carry the same grief and the same burden, even in my personal life. I couldn't bring myself to risk it again, loving and losing and going back into a world of hurt. I accepted it. I accepted that after Keith's murder, being a wife and mother would never be for me. But just before my window closed, a miracle happened. I married David and had my miracle twins, John David and Lucy. I never thought I would have joy in my life again, but I do. With that joy comes an overpowering drive to protect them, to never allow violence or evil to destroy their lives the way it nearly destroyed mine. So many times at night.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.